Policy shaping.
Policy shaping.
Did you make up that word? Because I'm not sure I understand what that word means.
Ah, so I did not make up the word policy, and I did not make up the word shaping.
No, I know that. No, I'm sorry. The combination of those two words.
Well, I'm not going to say I made it up, although maybe I did. One of the papers that we're going to read is actually a paper that I was a part of the author team on, and it's all about introducing the notion of policy shaping. And it's really a very simple idea. It's sort of what I just described, that what human beings are actually doing is giving you direct policy advice. And so they're trying to shape what the policy should be directly, as opposed to trying to say something about what rewards ought to be. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I guess now I'm... Before I was thinking about shaping differently, but now it's sort of feeling like sculpting to me. Like you have a policy out there and you're going to apply pressure and smoothing in different places to have it be a little bit different.
Right. So think about it this way. There's actually, I think, a direct way of doing this. When you do policy shaping, what have you actually done? What you've actually done is you've taken whatever the reward function was in, say, some particular state for some particular action, and let's say it was zero. And what you said is, no, this is the wrong answer, the wrong value. It should not be zero here. It should actually be something else. It should be, oh, I don't know, three. So you've actually replaced the original reward function R with another reward function R prime and said, this is actually the reward function that you should be learning over. And that's really what reward shaping does for you, right? I mean, if you think back to the examples that you were giving with all the reward shaping, you were replacing reward values. Agreed?
Yeah, though in the case where we were doing potential-based shaping, we also had to make sure that whenever we sprinkled some positive reward in, there was negative reward someplace else to balance it out, so you didn't get new positive reward cycles happening.
Right. Now, that's true, but regardless of where you sprinkle them and what kind of constraints you put up, you still took what was originally a reward value of something like zero and replaced it with another reward value.
I agree with that.
Plus three, minus three, seven, doesn't matter. So you've changed the reward function. So in exactly the same way, policy shaping is about changing the policy. There's some policy that the agent currently has, and you're saying, actually, in this state, rather than whatever it was you think you should do, in fact, this. So maybe I'm confirming what you already had. Maybe I'm telling you to do something different. But regardless, I'm overriding your policy function in the same way that in reward shaping, you're overriding the reward function.
Okay, that makes sense.
Right. So this is what policy shaping is all about. And it happens to line up with, it turns out in practice, the way people are actually trying to convey information. And so then the real question is, what do you do with this? How do I take this information that's being given, if it's not being given in the form of rewards, we know how to do that, but it's actually being given in the form of a policy, what should I actually do about it?
So I was interpreting what you described as saying, if a person gives positive feedback for an action in a state, and it's not the action that the agent would have taken in that state, then just replace it. Just make a modification of the policy so that that's the action that's taken. Is that the way to do it?
Well, ideally, that is what you would do, right? If a person tells you, look, you should go up here or you should eat a ghost here, you should just do it. But that actually requires something be true, which, as the lawyers would say, assumes facts, not in evidence. And that is that the person's actually right. What if the person's wrong?
Yeah, but certainly we should at least have that as our assumption. I mean, if we don't think the person's right, then this is a really easy thing to do policy shaping. Just ignore the person.
But what if the person's right most of the time but can occasionally be wrong?
I see.
Or what if the person's right but actually meant to say it the time step before?
I see. So maybe there's a way to use all these different things as evidence and then to combine them together to get, a best guess as to what the right answer is.
Exactly. And that's why it's policy shaping and not policy doing. So I'm going to try to give you a little quiz and see if we can kind of work out what the right thing to do is under the circumstances where a person might tell you to do something and might not always be right about it. Seem fair?
Yeah.